The fascination of playing around with the inspect element tool, or wondering how hackers can deface a website, is what got me into hacking back when I was a kid. That's why I decided to make this video, where I'll walk you through all the ways websites are hacked, and answer the questions of anyone who's as intrigued as I was. So let's get started.
Disclaimer.
This video is for cybersecurity enthusiasts and is for educational purposes only. It does not provide a step-by-step guide on how websites are hacked, but rather discusses the techniques used by hackers to exploit them.
Chapter number 1, Security Misconfigurations.
Okay, so starting off, you should know that for every website on the internet, there's the part that you're supposed to be able to see, and then there's also an administrative part to websites, with files and pages that you aren't supposed to see. These files and pages may contain information that the developer needs to run the website, or data that's crucial for its operations, and while they are generally kept hidden to prevent visitors from accessing them, many developers seem to overlook this basic security measure.
And leave the first door open for hackers to gain access to a website.
They may use hacking tools like Directory Buster to scan a website for exposed links, and find things like hidden web pages that may contain sensitive information, or login panels which can then be brute-forced using default usernames and passwords. Apart from this, another common way for hackers to gain access by playing with a website's URLs is through a file inclusion or a remote file inclusion attack. In a file inclusion attack, an attacker exploits a website by accessing the file system of its web server, and in order to illustrate this, imagine a site where each page is loaded from a file that is stored on its web server, and has a URL that looks something like this. Here, the page parameter specifies which file should be loaded from the server, and this is where if the website is poorly maintained or not configured to validate the instructions that are given to it, an attacker could trick it to open a sensitive system file stored on the web server, and ultimately gain access to it. In a remote file inclusion attack, instead of viewing the contents of a system file, an attacker exploits the dynamic URL to link a file which may be hosted on their own website, and compels the targeted site to fetch that file and run it on its web server, as it may install a backdoor and allow the hacker with an access into the server. Moving on, for the last security misconfiguration, we have the code injection attack. In this type of attack, an attacker embeds malicious file or script into an image using a technique known as steganography, and then uploads that image to the targeted website, in order for it to be executed by its web server. This type of attack is usually done on websites which don't sanitize the data that is given to them, and can allow an attacker to either change a website's content, or install a malware on its web server.
Chapter number 2, the SQL injection.
SQL is a language that is used to manage a website's database, and similar to the code injection attack we just talked about, in a SQL injection attack, an attacker uses a website's vulnerable input fields to send malicious SQL commands to its database, and perform a variety of illicit tasks, such as bypassing login forms, or modifying the data stored in its database. Now if you're interested in learning about how this attack is executed in detail, you can download the PDF that I've prepared by clicking on the link in the description down below, but nonetheless, if we take this admin panel of a website as an example, and try to log in into it, what the website will do is generate an SQL query like this to be sent to its database, and check whether the username and password we entered matches with the correct username and password stored in its database. However, if the website is vulnerable to SQL injection, and does not sanitize the input given to it, what a hacker can do here is basically enter a special SQL syntax like the double dash and space to comment out the rest of the query like this, and instruct the website to only look for the correct username, while ignoring the requirement to check for the correct password. This will ultimately result in a successful login attempt no matter what the password may be, and if you're not sure about what a comment is or how the logic behind all of this worked, I'll once again recommend you checking out the PDF mentioned earlier, as it also contains some information about the attacks that I went over before.
Chapter number 3, cross-site scripting attacks.
In a cross-site scripting attack, a hacker doesn't target the web server or the database of a website, but rather exploits the browsers of users visiting that website. This is done by writing a malicious code or script in the comment section or a vulnerable forum of the website, which is then executed by the browsers of users visiting that web page, and if you're interested in learning more about how this attack is executed in detail, potentially allowing a hacker to display pop-ups or gathering information on users, you can watch this video by the YouTube channel Loy Liang Yang, that I'll put a link to in the description down below.
Chapter number 4, the server-side forgery attack.
To understand what a server-side forgery or an SSRF attack is, imagine a website called royaltyconvert.com, which allows its users to convert a web page into a PDF and download it on their computer for free. Typically, users may come and convert a legitimate site like Article 123 to save it on their computer. However, if the website is vulnerable, and an attacker comes along, they could trick it into sending an authenticated request to its web server, and compel it to download a secure page stored on the server instead. This will ultimately result in the attacker using the website against itself to bypass its firewall and display sensitive information, and if you're interested in learning more, I'll put links to a few resources in the description down below.
Chapter number 5, DDoS attacks.
In a website DDoS attack, hackers use a
botnet,
which is a network of millions of infected computers all around the world, and send large amounts of data to a website at once. This overwhelms the website, slowing it down or crashing it completely, and such an attack is usually done to prevent legitimate users from accessing the site or disrupting the services it provides. Now, while these attacks are comparatively easier to do, as the botnets performing them can be rented by anyone from the dark web, their effectiveness can still be inconsistent, and some may not deliver the expected results, leaving the attacker exposed or at the risk of detection. Speaking of botnets, malware plays a crucial role not only in hacking websites, but also cybersecurity in general. That's why understanding and studying malware is important for everyone interested in the field, and this brings me to an essential tool I use for malware analysis called ANY.RUN. ANY.RUN is a free cloud-based sandbox that I featured in my previous video, and they are now celebrating their 8th anniversary with special offers that last until May 31st. You can get 6 months of free service, or extra licenses for yourself or your team, and I highly recommend checking them out to take advantage of this campaign. I personally use ANY.RUN to analyze suspicious files or links quickly and reliably, and if I come across something that might be dangerous, I upload it to ANY.RUN and see how the file behaves in a safe and controlled environment. It gives me actionable data, such as IOCs, which are clues that tell me if my computer or network has been attacked, or TDPs, which show me how a malware operates, what methods it uses, and the specific steps it takes to carry out an attack. So whether you're into cybersecurity, or need a reliable tool for malware analysis, I highly recommend checking out ANY.RUN, and exploring their anniversary offers to discover the advantages it can provide. Thanks for listening, let's get back to the video.
Chapter number 6, Practice Yourself.
Finally, it's time for you to learn more about the attacks we just talked about, and practice them on a vulnerable website, by watching different tutorials or walkthroughs on the internet. For this, you can download another PDF linked in the description down below, where I'll walk you through how to set up this vulnerable website on your home network, and practice your hacking skills on it. Anyway guys, so that's it for the video. If you have any questions, feel free to ask them in the comments section down below, and I'll see you in the next one.